all the viewers, all the listeners, all the learners. Welcome to CEC Gurukul Live. And today in the lecture, we will be looking at a very significant issue for students, practitioners, and all the people alike in the realm of economics, international affairs, policy making, amongst others. And the topic that we will be looking at today is energy security and global affairs. The structure of the learning and the lecture today is we will first be trying to understand energy, its significance for the realm of international business, for the realm of domestic politics, and also global affairs. Followed by that, we would be going on to understand what are the various sources of energy, the kind of challenges and opportunities they present, and then most important, what is the way forward for the future generation and the and our planet for energy security. Now, energy security is a practical concern. Earlier, it was primarily seen as a separate unit, but today, with new challenges and opportunities, it has emerged as distinct area of scholarly analysis. No doubt, when we look at the world around, there is great change and rapid pace of transformation of energy systems. What you can see here is that problem can no longer be effectively studied or resolved in isolation from each other. Today, energy is having such a rampant impact on various paradigms, be it be economics, international business, domestic avenues, that it has to be seen in an integrated way. So the topic of our learning today has practical concerns. We need to have a pragmatic approach to treat with it as a distinct area of scholarly analysis. No doubt, energy systems are witnessing great change, and within this great change, the problem needs to be effectively studied. And this analysis requires that we look at it in a holistic, integrated way, not in an isolated manner. Now, when we try to understand energy security, we have to see that energy security challenges have evolved over a period of time as human population multiplied, as our needs also increased. Therefore, energy security also faced various challenges. When we try to look at energy security, we have to look at it in a tandem with oil and geopolitics also. Now, let's try to situate the notion of energy security in the post-Second World War time. Now, as you all appreciate that the First World War was a European phenomena with how European powers, because of imperialism, mutual rivalry, the European continent was put on a scale of war. This insecurity further led to Second World War. When we look at how with the Treaty of Versailles, how with the entire rivalry, how because of rise of aggressive economic nationalism, somewhere nations wanted to safeguard their interests. And amidst this, the notion of security was military. And this security, this idea of security as military security, was often linked to energy security. So energy security, therefore, when we try to look at it in the contemporary time, in that is mostly when we try to situate it in the post-Second World War era, It is a byproduct of number of complex factors. By complex factors, we mean that factors which are having their own contested realms, thereby there is not an easy solution to any issues that arise out of them, namely international trade, supply and pricing. Oil and geopolitics are also part of this paradigm. Energy security, therefore, has to factor into account, or any debate or energy security cannot exclude the complexities involved in international trade, supply, pricing. Now, whenever we try to look at the sources of energy, the first one is namely the fossil fuel. Now, we all are aware that fossil fuel is a term used to describe a group of energy sources that were formed when ancient plants and organisms were subjected to intense heat and pressure over millions of years. So therefore, fossil fuels, by its very definition, are non-renewable. Now, when we try to look at fossil fuels, two very important sources of fossil fuel, coal, as you all know, formed from ferns, petals, trees, which harden due to pressure and heat. Oil, formed from smaller organisms like the zooplankton and the algae. Today, coal and oil, they really guard the contours of world politics and also supremacy of international business. But alongside that, there are new avenues, attempts to discover new sources of energy also. So when we try to understand the idea of energy security, namely from the very first thing, that security in global affairs has been seen in military terms. Dear learners, let us bring to you a thinker, a realist thinker, who laid the foundation of the neo-realist structural school of realism that we say, that is Kenneth Waltz. Now, Kenneth Waltz's main idea, that is, states are the main actors of analysis of international politics. States are the main focus, as they have structural power within international relations. As we all know, realism believes in 3 S: statism, survival, self-help. Kenneth Waltz extends this idea, that is, yes, states definitely struggle for survival within an international system that is marked by and characterized by an absence of a worldwide authority. And this structural position is defined as anarchy. Now, within this anarchy, how do we situate energy and the notion of security? Therefore, Kenneth Waltz predicted that oil shocks, for example, that were provoked by Arab export embargo, would not constitute any change of power for the West. However, history had a different answer. The aftermath of the oil shocks of 1973, Kenneth Waltz argues that there is a continuity of strategies of major Western states in energy geopolitics. So therefore, political actors change, national strategy remains. So therefore, when we try to look at security, it can be defined as per 2 parameters, defensive and offensive. Let's understand them. Defensive security is in relation to a threat. Offensive security is optimizing of profits in relations with other actors. Now, the Waltzian meaning of security, when we try to understand, is mainly defensive, that is, security from the anarchical structure of international system. But energy security, when we try to contrast, it is offensive, as it is the only about vulnerable issues of the states. They prefer to use the offensive strategy, that is optimizing points of profits in relation with other actors. Now, what we have to see here is that today in the global landscape, energy security exists in tandem with contemporary challenges as well as opportunities. There is diversification in the global landscape. By diversification, we understand that today the world is multipolar. We are no longer in the Cold War era when there was bipolarity in international politics. Oil and gas pipelines. When you pick up newspapers, when you look at analysis of several contemporary events, oil and gas pipelines are instruments of hybrid warfare. Yes, alongside that, there are price shocks. Prices are fluctuating. And then with globalization, markets have become integrated. With globalization, there is rampant rise of information and communications. So therefore, technological innovation also has an impact on energy securities. And then of course, the fact is that energy resources, especially the fossil fuels, are scarce in relation to our demands. The demand is limited, is unlimited, but the supply is limited. So therefore, energy resources have their own vulnerability, and these vulnerabilities too have a huge bearing on then how do we define or how do we situate energy security. And all these factors, with diversification of global landscape, hybrid warfare involved in oil and gas pipelines, sudden price shocks, rampant and vivid integrated markets, entire paradigm of technological innovations, definitely leads to vulnerabilities which are also seen in crisis diplomacy. Now, so therefore, one thing that is coming forward in this discussion that we are having, that the term energy security is ubiquitous. There is no defined, accepted notion of what we really imply by energy security. The idea of energy security is also related to resource nationalism, the quest to safeguard your own resource with respect to use by the others. The idea of energy security then is also related to mixed dynamics of international conflict. As we have seen in our ongoing discussion, that conflicts have complex angles. Conflicts are contested. There is no one particular axiom that can be blamed as the cause. There similarly, in the same way, there is no particular solution that can be looked upon as the ultimate solution. There is integrated power, market power, the dynamics, the price, the institutions, and the technical details too associated with respective infrastructures, firm level behavior into models of strategic interaction. So therefore, what we see here is that today entire energy security cannot be seen in isolation. We have to look at it in an integrated way, namely energy availability, affordability, reliability, and most important today, sustainability is the most important criteria to judge any source, And therefore, energy and international conflict too are not isolated from being adjusted on the parameter of sustainability. Now, once again, let's delve into some theories, theoretical positions that give us some clarity on how do we situate energy security. I present to you the argument first by the Copenhagen School of Security Studies. For them, security is not considered to be a direct consequence of threat, but it is rather defined as the result of political interpretation of the threat, a process that we call as securization. Followed by that, we have the regional security complex theory, that is, more threats travel more easily over short distances than the long ones. Security interdependence is normally into regionally based clusters, that is, security complexes. Process of securitization and thus the degree of security independence are more intense between actors inside such as complexes than they were between actors inside the complex and outside of it. So therefore, what you see here is, amidst this debate, that we have proved oil reserves. These oil reserves provide geopolitical clout and energy security also to nations involved in it. But alongside that, there is a crude fact, that is, there is peak demand but stranded assets. And somewhere we are looking at a phase where there is a debate that is this the end of the fossil fuel area, the climate threat from carbon rich energy, and yes, the entire issue of quest for cleaner fuels. So amidst all these nations and their policies, domestic issues, international business, global politics are trying to draw out contours of what can be actually defined as, or what can be actually be the right idea of energy security. So therefore, today diplomacy, international community, are looking at the need for stable and secure markets. Of course, stable and secure markets are essential for economic progress. But we have to also see that by 2030, if we take a futuristic perspective, emerging economies will consume 2/3 of world's energy. And at the same time, alongside working out the demand and supply of various sources of energy, what is needed is strong environmental leadership, because environment is one of the non-traditional security dimensions that has to be factored in any analysis of issues for international business as well as global politics. So what you see here is that there is a threat to security of energy supplies, be it as we saw, oil, gas pipelines, petroleum reserves, amongst others. An example, any attack on a single tanker is seen today as an assault on the entire international community. There are forums at United Nations, at global diplomatic summits, where this idea of an attack on energy resource as an attack on the entire international community is stated and pledged with, because energy and the depletion thereof makes the stakeholders indeed vulnerable. There is violation of core values of free trade, peace and prosperity. Nations diffuse and de-escalate the current threat and are also looking at it to ensure regional stability. Today, the significance of energy security is so paramount that security of energy supplies is one of the main points of analysis, one of the main points of negotiation for global diplomatic and business emissaries. So therefore, energy supplies have to be secure, because any attack on trade is an attack on free, on prosperity and peace. So therefore, nations look at avenues of negotiation to diffuse and de-escalate the current threats to energy supplies. Now, when we trying to understand energy security, let's also look at certain institutional parameters, institutions and organizations that are working to help and boost the notion of energy security. First is International Energy Association, that was International Energy Agency, which is there to ensure reliable, affordable and clean energy. IEA was founded in the year 1974. When we try to look at its major mandate, we'll try to get an idea as to how the idea of energy and the stakeholders and users therein is also witnessing new challenges. IEA tries to help countries to coordinate a collective response to major disruptions to oil supply. IEA attempts to get all stakeholders together to present a global energy dialogue. IEA tries to look at the shared energy as well as the environmental concern. IEA is also involved in annual studies, and these annual studies provide a basis of research that everyone ponders over as to what is the direction of energy and the issue of energy security thereof. Its forecasts on oil, natural gas, coal, electricity, renewables are indeed significant in their own way. So when we try to look at areas of focus for IEA and for various other stakeholders too, so energy security, that is looking at diversity, efficiency and flexibility within all energy sectors, economic development, promoting free markets and energy sector investment to foster economic growth and eliminate energy poverty, environmental awareness, enhancing international knowledge of options to tackle climate change, engagement worldwide, that is opening the doors of the IEA fraternity to emerging economies. Dear listeners, you must visit the website. That's the source of this understanding of functions and visions of IEA, that is www.iaea.org. Do visit there and try to get some more idea into the working of such international organizations, and how do they balance engagement, economic development, environmental awareness, amongst others. So therefore, as you know that today we are living in a world that is defined by digitalization. Another concern when we are trying to look at the idea of energy security is how digital technological innovations are opening new opportunities for energy efficiency enhancement. Today, several multinational corporations involved in energy, policymakers, bureaucratic apparatus are looking at the vast potential of energy efficiency, trying to balance it with greenhouse gas reductions. And how can one have improved energy security where growth is friendly to the environment and also having social benefits? So therefore, today one of the most important agenda of discussion is digitalization and energy efficiency. Today, stakeholders are looking at as to how the potential of energy efficiency can be enhanced, balancing environment, social benefits and profits with rampantly changing digital technological innovation. Some of the areas which are also being looked upon is to fill in the innovation gaps across the energy system, securing investments in low carbon power generation, encouraging greater international collaboration on data gathering. As you all know, data is the new currency of power. Nations are getting together to foster greater international support on the idea of authentic data gathering, and also looking at the challenges and opportunities that lie in global trade in new areas of energy like liquefied natural gas. Now, when we try to look at the geopolitics of energy, we have to see that oil-rich countries or energy-rich countries, to name for example Iran, Venezuela, Saudi Arabia, Libya, there are uncertainties involved in their political as well as economic cycles. To take an example, the attack on the two tankers that happened in the Gulf of Oman before easily backsliding. So therefore, world trade growth patterns also are witnessing ups and downs, and somewhere there is slow pace demand growth. When we look at the Vienna Agreement oil ministers, they are also faced with short-term uncertainty over the strength of demands and relentless supply growth from their competitors. So there, and when we try to look at the other aspect, that there are weak growth in global refining throughput, maybe because of high levels of maintenance in the United States and Europe, or issues of low runs in Japan and Korea. All these have a significant bearing on the energy situation in global politics and international business thereof. So therefore, when we try to look at that, when we try to situate the institutional paradigm of energy security, we also let's have a look at OPEC. Now, what is OPEC? The OPEC is Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries, beginning its way back from September 1960. Today, OPEC has come in a big way, being an international organization with 11 oil exporting developing countries as its members. OPEC always tries to put forward the idea of permanent sovereignty over finite natural resources. And this issue of OPEC has also been outlined in United Nations resolutions. When we try to look at the OPEC statute, which was first adopted in 1965, that is safeguarding of their interests and the securing of a steady income for them, because petroleum sales are a main source of revenue. Petroleum revenue developed economies in a viable and sustainable manner. OPEC also tries to look at the issue of stabilization of oil prices, as we have seen that oil prices are fluctuating, and this idea of putting prices per barrel definitely has a huge stake for any nation to drive out its policy in the realm of energy security. Efficient, economic, and regular supply of petroleum to consuming countries, fair returns to investors, and balancing out, therefore, the trade-off and negotiation between producers, consumers, and investors. So what we see here is that application of energy, environmental harmony, sustainable development, and eradication of poverty. As we all know, that oil is the leading source of commercial energy. Therefore, any energy source which any forum or organization like OPEC or IEA tries to think upon has to look at sufficiency, accessibility, versatility, the ease of transport, and in many areas too, low cost. So these are important aspects that have a bearing on energy security too. Now, when we are trying to look at energy security, today with diversification of energy resources, an important source of energy is solar energy. As you all know that solar resource rich countries, if we put that, they are lying fully or partially between the two tropics of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. Solar energy presents opportunities to bring prosperity, energy security, and sustainable development to their people. Solar resource rich countries need to act in a coordinated manner, when the need of the hour for that is strong political impulse, harmonizing and aggregating the demand, because demand for energy is huge. One has to channelize it via solar energy and at the same time work on solar finance, technologies, innovation, and capacity building. Now I present to you an important idea of International Solar Alliance. Being in India, we must appreciate the fact that International Solar Alliance provide a dedicated platform for cooperation amongst solar resource rich countries, where the global community, including bilateral and multilateral organizations, corporates, industries, and other stakeholders, can make a positive contribution to assist and help achieve the common goals of increasing the use of solar energy in meeting energy needs of prospective ISA member countries in a safe, convenient, affordable, equitable, sustainable manner. You must visit the website of www.isa.org to find out about this great initiative which has been taken. And this International Solar Alliance is the first international and intergovernmental organization of 121 countries. India is proud to take lead here. The headquarters of International Solar Alliance are in India. United Nations is a strategic partner to it, and the focus of ISA has been to bring clean and affordable energy within the reach of all and create a sustainable world. There has been attempt by ISA for deployment of solar energy for achieving universal energy access and energy security of the present and future generations. So when we try to look at ISA, we have to also appreciate the role played by India in getting this alliance together. Another significant institution that we have to understand while understanding sources of energy and its bearing on our international energy security is IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency. When we see that 1970, we had a treaty on the non-proliferation of nuclear weapons. That is, today there are 190 states as parties. And the IAEA that we will be trying to see is though no doubt a part, not a party to the treaty, but it is entrusted with key roles and responsibilities. That is, when we try to look at the mandate of working of IAEA, and the source that I quote to you is www.iaea.org. That is, it administers international safeguards to verify that non-nuclear weapon states party to the NPT fulfill the non-proliferation commitment they have made with a view to prevent the diversion of nuclear energy from peaceful to nuclear weapons or other nuclear explosive devices. So therefore, when we are trying to look at nuclear energy as a source of energy, the role of IAEA also becomes crucial, because it facilitates and provides a channel for endeavors aimed at further development of the applications of nuclear energy for peaceful purposes, especially in the territories of non-nuclear weapon states party to the treaty, with due consideration for the needs of the developing areas of the world. So therefore, IAEA also has to go on to the verification of nuclear weapon free zones in the context of verifying ex-nuclear weapon material. So therefore, what you see here is that today sources of energy are being debated and diversified. The conventions are focusing on clean energy generation in the new future. To name a few, United Nations Sustainable Energy for All, Sustainable Development Goals, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. All these are doing their bit in working out mechanisms for clean energy generation in the near future. Then also at the same time, when nations are fearing shortfalls in the fuel supply to thermal plants, looking at the fact of increasing cost of fuel, therefore renewable energy like hydropower is also being looked as being capable of complementing existing sources of energy to meet the demands of the people when explored to the fullest extent. An example here is Kenya looking at hydropower as a source of energy. Now, when we try to look at hydropower, in the case of India, let me quote to you an interesting article that has recently come, and it's by Brahma Chalini, that today India is looking at Bay of Bengal initiative for multi-sectoral technical and economic cooperation, that is BIMSTEC, as a forum to factor in regional cooperation. But so the argument that Brahma Chalini gives is that multilateral cooperation on water and hydropower resources is very essential. When we look at our neighborhood, Bhutan, Myanmar have vast untapped hydropower resources. So therefore, Bhutan is also stepping up at this Indian collaboration with a reservoir-based 2585 megawatt project on the river Sankrosh that is larger than any dam in India. Water increasingly, therefore, will be a crucial and critical factor in regional development. And this hydro diplomacy gives us new avenues for energy security too, because what you see here is that they exert stronger leadership on the trans-border water issues. And that is the need of the hour, to exert stronger leadership on the trans-boundary water issues. So therefore, what we see here is, at one point, there is scarcity of supply. Other point, there is import dependence. Then there is competition for unclaimed or uncontested hydrocarbon resources. And of course, the debate that is state versus private ownership of energy resources. Now, when we try to look at the world regions, no doubt Middle East holds a very large proportion of world's proven oil reserves. But again, let's also not ignore the fact of the crisis that happened within the Middle East and the West Asian, that is Suez crisis in 1956, the Arab-Israel war 1967, the Iranian revolution 1979, the Iraq war in 1980 to 88, and now of course the 1990, that is the Gulf War crisis. So therefore, regions which are having proven oil reserves are also having their own certainties, which have a bearing also on the larger debate on energy security. And at the same time, the structural perspective that richest energy producing regions are at a loggerhead or in a contrast to the way poor suffer the daily insecurity of energy poverty and the continued dependence on fossil fuels. So therefore, when you look at the world in the form of north-south divide, rich versus poor divide, energy security is a major global challenge of the 21st century. I would like to conclude this lecture with the book that we referred, that is by Ronald Daniorther, saying that energy security as a value that is constantly and continuous in a dynamic conflict with other core value, namely economic prosperity, sustainability. At the same time, we have to see that different physical properties of key energy resources, renewable or non-renewable, coal, oil, gas, nuclear, etc., that we all saw in our discussion, are critical for the differing manifestations of energy security. So therefore, social, economic, political contexts are developing over time and pace, and this has a bearing, and they are essential for fuller appreciation of contemporary energy challenges. So therefore, when we try to look at the main idea of the book Energy Security by Roland, we get to the conclusion of our learning that today there is unique role being played by power and justice, and this is adding to the complexities of issue of energy security today. Today there is inclusion of transnational dimension on the debate of energy security. Therefore, this issue has to be seen with social justice at the same time with sustainability, because in the larger run, the future of our planet, our livelihood, our international affairs and all forms of work that we do, they are very much dependent on the social, political, strategic effect of energy security. So, dear listeners, do refer to this book by Roland on energy security to give you a clear idea of the complexities of energy security today. Today, state versus market debate, vulnerability versus diplomacy, transnational dimension, technological innovation, social justice versus sustainability, all of it are part and parcel of the debate on energy security, and they have to be given due analysis, which has to be seen in a holistic way in relation to the other and not in isolation. So this was about energy security, sources of energy, diversification, role of major players, impact of technological dimension, impact of environmental awareness, the need to balance energy security with economic development. And as any issue of public discourse, it is an ongoing one. New developments are taking place, and the need of the hour here is to take the discourse forward, keeping track of contemporary developments and appreciating the significance of energy security, not only for global affairs, but also for domestic politics, international business, learners, practitioners, students, academia, media alike.